thanks for tuning in to No Wine in No Time. I'm your host, Dave, and today we're going to discuss wines made from fruits other than grapes. So try to envision yourself walking through a farmer's market. It's the end of summer, the harvest is in, and fruit is abundant everywhere. We're enjoying fresh apricots, peaches, raspberries, plums, all the beautiful fruit that summer has to offer. Now imagine those fruits in your glass. Well, that idea is not as far-fetched as you might think. Now, it's no coincidence that the grape was chosen to be the perfect fruit to produce wine. The reason for that is a grape has an ideal balance of acid, sugar, tannins, and water. And because of that, wines need to be tweaked very little to produce exceptional quality. Now, with fruited wines, those wines may need a little bit of a nudge one way or another. So let's talk about producing wine on a very high level. So if we think about taking fruit, we have to crush the fruit to create juice. Once the juice is made, then we introduce yeast or use the natural yeast that's on the fruit itself to start a process called fermentation. Fermentation eats up the sugar and converts that to alcohol, producing carbon dioxide in the process. Well, once that fermentation has taken place, then what we need to do is actually filter the wine, in other words, remove some of the solid particles, stabilize the wine, and of course, bottle the wine. So now let's look a little bit at fruited wines. With grapes, that process pretty much starts itself and runs from beginning to end. Now let's look at fruited wines, and let's think about a fruit that maybe has a very high sugar content and a very low acid content. In that particular situation, that particular wine may produce either a very sweet wine or a very highly alcoholic wine, but because the acidity level is low, either we need to add some acid to the wine to create a balance, or we'll create a very unbalanced wine. Let's think about a piece of fruit that maybe has low sugar content but higher acidity. In that particular situation, when we're producing that wine, we may need to add a little bit of sugar to, the proper term is chaptalize the wine. What we're doing there is creating enough sugar to be able to have sufficient alcohol content or to produce a wine that has the sugar content that we find most desirable. If indeed we have a wine where the acid content, let's say, is completely out of control, very high, then we may also want to add water to the mix. Well, when water is added, we now dilute the flavors, and we may need to add sugar in the process. So think about it. Adding sugar, adding acid, adding water, we're nudging the wine one way or another to create a more balanced product in the end. With grapes, we generally don't have to do that because it's kind of the perfect package to begin with. So when we think about fruited wines, we can think about all types of beautiful fruits that they can be made from. Things like bananas, apples, peaches, apricots, pineapple, pomegranates, mangoes, even obscure things like dandelions. If it has sugar content in it, we can create wine from it. So why would we seek out a wine that is different from the traditional grape wine that we're used to? Well, maybe we enjoy some of those delicious summer flavors, and we want to have that all year long. We want to taste summer in our glass. Well, a fruited wine gives you the opportunity to do that. So I've picked one here today, and we're going to talk about this one a little bit and kind of use it as a broad brush example of what we might expect from other fruited wines. So this particular one comes to us from the St. James Winery, and I chose this wine specifically because it's 100% made from raspberries. So when we think about some of the cheap fruited wines that are in wine stores, things like Arbor Mist, things like Wild Vine, they take an inferior grape wine and they add fruit to it to try to make a better summation. This is made 100% from the fruit itself and extremely high quality. So think about how many red raspberries or black raspberries it takes to produce a bottle of wine. Quite a few. So the St. James Winery is located in St. James, Missouri, and this particular wine, 100% raspberry. So let's take a look at the wine and see what we might be able to expect. Like most fruited wines, these wines are a little bit transparent, so I can actually see through it. It's clear at the edges and really a nice, a pretty raspberry color. Now, if we swirl to liberate some of the aromas, what we're going to get leaping out of the glass of this fruit wine or any other fruit wine is a pure expression of the fruit itself. All I smell is beautiful, delicious, ripe raspberries coming out of this glass. So think about a grape wine. We often talk about that grape wine having, let's say, raspberry aromas, plum flavors, a little bit of cherry at the core. Well, none of those fruits are in your grape wine. That's the magic of fermenting grapes and how those grapes take on multiple personalities. With fruited wine, it's a bit different. It's pretty much a one-trick pony. If this is raspberry wine, it's going to smell like raspberries, and you can bet it's going to taste like raspberries. So let's go ahead and give it a sip. So across the palate, it literally feels like I've taken a whole bunch of beautiful ripe raspberries, put them in my mouth, and I've chewed them. I have delicious raspberry flavor, but I'm not getting essences of things like spices, things like different fruits. It's manifesting itself as raspberry wine. And that's exactly what you get from this particular category. So I'm going to enjoy a little bit more of this St. James raspberry wine. And I thank you so much for tuning in. And please come back next time, because soon you'll know wine in no time.